Hello and welcome to Fierce. This program celebrates the diversity of LGBTIQ identities and perspectives. Fierce is produced in Bundjalung country at 2NCR Lismore and can also be heard on podcast at fiercefm.podbean.com and in New Zealand on Fresh FM, as well as all over Australia through the Community Radio Network. This is Peter Lena, and I want to acknowledge the traditional owners of the lands where you are listening. They took care of these lands sustainably for hundreds of thousands of years and then shared this land with us at great cost to their own lives. I want to honour and thank them for the work they have done and continue to do to care for country and to sit on the earth. I also want to thank the fairies and crones who came before us in history to fight for our human rights to love fiercely.
Hi, I'm Ken Pack. I'm an organiser at Community Action for Rainbow Rights, and you're listening to Fierce FM.
On the phone, we have Emmanuel Penny from Corrigu Village, Papua New Guinea. Hi, Manu, how are you?
Hey, Peter, and hello, everyone listening in. I'm fine, I'm good.
Something that's happening over in your village, which is scary.
There is a large open pit mine, the feeder mine, up to the mountains, and I live along the banks of the Pacific River, one of the largest rivers in the world. All our lives are connected to the river. The river is us, and we are the river.
I know that that means that not only do you use a river for watering the garden or whatever, all your food comes from the river, and also you drink the water straight from the river and you wash in the river. It's actually one of the last wild, pristine river systems in the world and one of the largest. There's over 50,000 people, including your village, living connected to this water. And so the threat of a Chinese mine polluting that water is dire.
It's not just a Chinese mine, working together with the Australian government and under laws.
Okay. You've always told me before that even though it's got an office in Brisbane, all the money goes to China.
The Penoff company is owned by a company in Guangdong province, or I think it's part of the government. And it's registered in Australia as an Australian company called Penoff.
And so how is this fight going to take place? Do you have a plan?
We have very basic campaign strategy. First is we organize resistance at the grassroots level, where the people are going to be affected directly. People along the river from the top near the mine all the way down to the mouth of the river. Everyone's against the mine, but they're fearful of the government and the government using the police and the army. So that's the first strategy. The second is, because we know China wouldn't really give a damn about us. If we go to China and make a noise out in the street, we'd probably get arrested. And because we know that the company's head office is down in Brisbane, we're planning on coming into Brisbane and making a big noise out there so that the Australians will know that it's a Chinese company operating in Australia in the pretext and telling them that everyone is against the mine. It's just you and a couple of politicians. Another message to Australians would be, look, you don't benefit out of this mine. They're just here using your law and your safety law and an image that it's not a Chinese mine, and so people will be more relaxed about it. We would like Australians to know about that. And lastly, we have hired several lawyers. We're putting together a large lawsuit to take the mine and the government to court over the breaches of all the different laws that are providing the framework for mining activities in Papua New Guinea.
And so there's over 50,000 people living on the Sepi River in a Garden of Eden where everything you need is coming from the river and you're just living a very simple, sustainable, subsistence farming lifestyle. I imagine it's not the only river that this has happened to in Papua New Guinea.
No, the Australian operated BHP or petty mining has completely devastated the entire life of the Fly River. It's after 30 years, and so now all the heavy metals that have been deposited that now manifesting in the different diseases, especially internal illnesses faced by people along that river. It was another great disaster. It's out at Bougainville, where there was a civil war that broke out because they were beginning to see the impact that they were like off petty. And the cities and the people of my area know this very well. One, a civil war. Two, a disaster of the natural wildlife and the life of the people. We believe that the Chinese mining company, and at the rate at which they are going, they are following any rules, they're breaking the rules as we speak, as I'm on the phone now, right now. And they have not any good track records around the world and in Papua New Guinea, so we're really fearful of that.
Did you say that Papua New Guinean government was at war with the villagers? Is that what the war was?
Yes, the Papua New Guinean government was at war with the people who resisted the mine. There are lots and lots of tragic stories, but over 10,000 Bougainvilleans were killed. And they were not killed in a respectful way. The Australians supplied the army of Papua New Guinea with helicopters, and they were fired from helicopters.
What can we do here in Australia to help you and support you and to try and resist the mine and also civil war?
This mining company is registered under the Australian law, and their office is in Brisbane. Almost 80% of the company is owned by Chinese government. They're registered in Australia. It's rightful that Australians stand up with us. One, because Australians don't necessarily own the company. A lot of Australians won't benefit from it. And number two, we have long-term historical relationships. We're neighbors. How can you watch while that happens? They're using your name, your law, to come up here and destroy our lives. 50,000 plus people. It's not just our lives. It's a complete culture. When you say Pacific River, or when you say Avistak, Avistak is a life in itself. It's the people, the language, the customs, tradition. It's the essence of pretty much our survival. We shouldn't stand and watch while it happened, like in Fly River or Teddy, where it's completely lifeless now. And we shouldn't sit back and watch another civil war like Bougainville, where maybe 20,000 plus people from my area would be killed, because the government is adamant, and we know that the government will bring the fight to us. We want to also get to where the shareholders are. If the Chinese government owns 80%, then who owns the other 20%? If it's Australians, we want to know what is Australian. So we want to ask them, why are you doing this? And hopefully, if you can stand up with us and challenge the company first and foremost, then your leaders will also listen and maybe ask the questions to our politicians here.
Are you hopeful that you can stand up against this company?
I'm not hopeful, I'm determined.
Well, listeners, Emmanuel Penny is a master storyteller and author of an acclaimed PNG novel, Sibona. He is visiting his Nimba, which is us, in Mullumbimby, and we want to invite you along to a feast of stories and songs and Melanesian sweets. It's going to be an enchanting evening with some rich tales of life on the Sepik. Manu will also be visiting Sydney, Melbourne and Brisbane to try and raise awareness to protect the people on the Sepik. Isn't that right, Manu?
That's right.
Well, thank you so much for coming on Fierce.
Thank you, Peter. It's been a pleasure chatting with you.
Hello Australia, this is Ray Isaac, Sydney DJ and singer. I am on the best radio show ever in Australia, in Lismore, Fierce FM.
Sam Smith, who came out as a non-binary genderqueer in March, has now changed their pronouns officially to they, them. In fact, the Brit Awards were considering introducing a gender-neutral category. And this is exactly the kind of thing that this kind of influence has. So Sam saying I'm non-binary and my pronouns are they, them. And then the Brit Awards saying they're going to scrap gendered categories. That's the impact of being such a high-profile non-binary person. They didn't have to do that. They're in a very high-pressure situation. And I think it's an amazingly selfless thing that they've done. and I'm all for it. This is Sam Smith doing a cover of Joni Mitchell.
It's coming on Christmas, the cutting down trees, the putting up a reindeer and singing songs of joy and peace. Oh, I wish I had a river I could skate away on. But it don't snow here, it stays pretty green. I'm gonna make a lot of money and then I'm gonna quit this crazy scene. Oh, I wish I had a river I could skate away on. I wish I had a river so long I would teach my feet to fly. Oh, I wish I had a river I could skate away on. I made my baby cry. He tried hard to help me, you know. He put me at ease and he loved me so naughty. Made me weak in the knees. Oh, I wish I had a river I could skate away on. I'm so hard to handle, I'm selfish and I'm sad. Now I've kinda lost the best baby that I ever had. Oh, I wish I had a river I could skate away on. I wish I had a river so long I would teach my feet to fly. Oh, I wish I had a river I could skate away on. I made my baby say goodbye. It's coming on Christmas, the cutting down trees, the putting up a reindeer and singing songs of joy and peace. Oh, I wish I had a river I could skate away on.
If Scummo's religious discrimination bill passes through Parliament, bigots will be handed all new rights to discriminate against LGBTIQ people again. But not only them, also women, people of colour, people with disabilities, and anyone who has ever won protection from discrimination is set to be dragged down by this bigot's bill of rights. And we're chatting to Ken Pack, who is studying at Sydney University.
Hi, Ken.
Hi, thank you for having me.
Oh, it's a pleasure. Thank you for doing all you're doing. Oh my goddess, are we going back to a time where we're going to have to pretend we're not gay if we're a teacher?
Unfortunately, that's already the case at religious schools, but with this bill, we could see that being entrenched.
So we've got a Catholic school here in Lismore. They've got two trans students, and so therefore they've got no gendered uniform. Anybody could wear a skirt or a pant option as long as they're dressed up nicely. Are all religious schools different? Will some religious schools who are a bit more open suddenly not be allowed to be open?
I think up to the discretion of these religious schools, and it's good to hear that there's a school in Lismore which is inclusive to LGBTI plus students. But unfortunately, I think they're in the minority when it comes to the people running religious institutions, because there have been many cases where teachers have been sacked, even just for their opinion on marriage equality. This bill will definitely make it easier for bigotry to go through unchecked.
Who is behind this bill?
So the main proponents are the Christian right and their friends in the current Liberal government. This month, the Anglican Diocese of Sydney said that the bill should go further than what they already do by narrowing the legal protections against vilification. So someone who wants to prove that they're being harassed and discriminated in the workplace, they just don't want that opportunity to exist for marginalised groups, it seems. Also, at a recent National Press Club debate, the Australian Christian Lobby spoke in favour of the new law, which isn't surprising since they were the primary bankrollers in the No campaign during the marriage equality plebiscite of 2017. It seems that the Attorney General, Christian Porter, who is responsible for the draft legislation, has slightly moderated his stance given the criticism from queer advocacy groups, businesses, progressive religious bodies like the Uniting Church and the Australian Human Rights Commission. But at the same time, it's important to know that the Christian right are really intense about getting this bill through, so they're pressuring him.
And so it's a bit of a backlash from the plebiscite, that horrible thing we had to go through that caused a lot of youth suicide. We know that they cannot go back to making marriage illegal because of that plebiscite, but how can they now do this?
Yeah, rather than repeal marriage equality, which would be intensely unpopular, they've decided to take up other areas where LGBTI rights can be compromised. They're also chipping away on the rights of other marginalised groups, including women, people of colour, and people with disabilities.
Oh my goddess. How do you feel, Ken, being a young man at university? You know, you're doing the good fight and you're helping your community, but how's your heart?
It's a massive step backward for LGBTI rights and the rights of other groups. And so it needs to be opposed, fought back against, and defeated. The fact that I live in a big city like Sydney makes it easier. I think this will disproportionately impact LGBTI people, marginalized groups living in the regions, because the number of facilities you have access to, such as doctors, pharmacists, are much more limited there. But this bill, what it will do is enshrine the right to discriminate for healthcare professionals. So a pharmacist might say, I'm not going to provide contraception to anyone who's not married. A doctor might refuse to treat the child of a single parent or same-sex couple.
So we'll be back to living in ghettos.
It's quite eerily reminiscent, in my opinion, of, you know, will we go back to probably, hopefully not, something like Jim Crow, where signs that say, no black people, you know, no Jews. Doctors will put out signs saying, no one who is LGBTI.
Oh my goddess, yeah, that just reminded me. I was living in Rose Bay just like 20 years ago, and the Rose Bay Golf Club had that sign, no blacks. And they wouldn't allow anyone with dark skin to be in there.
Yeah, it's really bad what the implications of this bill will be.
So you've just had a rally. Was that the first rally you've had?
No, it wasn't the first rally. We had, back in August, over 500 people marched from Taylor Square in Sydney. That was before the draft of the religious discrimination bills were released, but there were proposals from the government that they were going to move forward with this. That protest very clearly demonstrated that the community was going to oppose it, especially when polls show that 80% of Australians think religious schools shouldn't be able to simply expel or sack students and teachers simply because of who they are.
So what can we do to help the cause?
The good news is that there is an opportunity to fight back and defeat this attack. It doesn't involve writing a letter to your MP so it can get chucked in the bin, but protests across the country are happening this month. Sydney just happened, but there'll be protests in Melbourne, Canberra, Adelaide and Perth. Everyone who wants to fight back against this homophobic and transphobic government should join these protests, because politicians almost never listen to opinion polls unless we take it to the streets in our numbers.
Is this a similar backlash that's been happening in America?
I think it is definitely similar, because America's religious freedom bills swept a number of states following their legalization of marriage equality. Trump is continuing this warpath of the bitter conservatives. He established the Religious Freedom Task Force, which is a well-funded group of Department of Justice, government lawyers who would defend discrimination against LGBTI plus people. They're also the ones who are currently in the Supreme Court arguing that the 1964 Civil Rights Act shouldn't apply to LGBTI plus workers. We're also seeing the rise of the far right globally. And I think that's definitely relevant to what the government is pushing with this bill. In Poland, the Law and Justice Party, they're currently in government. They're whipping up anti-LGBTI hatred to create a scapegoat following the viciously racist campaign against migrants and refugees. Their provincial and local governments declared certain areas of Poland LGBT-free zones back in July, which eerily reminded people of anti-Semitism during the 1930s. There have also been physical backlashes by violent far-right and fascist groups when activists have organized pride protests. But it's not all doom and gloom, because the good news is, despite all the odds of fighting a far-right government, Polish LGBTI plus activists have shifted public opinion in their favour. Recently, it was reported anti-queer prejudice in the country plummeted from 41 to 24%, and that was all because of their work, mobilising protests in the streets. That's what we can also do here in Australia, and that's what our sisters and brothers in the US are doing.
So in Poland and America and in Australia and in other places around the world, Russia, Papua New Guinea, so many places, Iran, people hate LGBTIQ so much that sometimes they kill them. Certainly they don't want them to have rights, and certainly they don't want them to get health care. Do you have any sense of why this hatred? Is it only coming from religious organizations that are controlling people? Or is it coming from other community groups that aren't religious based as well?
I think it's important to recognize the diversity of opinion within religious groups. I think that's demonstrated here in Australia with the attitude of the Uniting Church versus the Anglican Church. I think politics is just as diverse within religious organizations. And I think this definitely has much more to do with your politics, whether you're homophobic or transphobic, than what religion you are, especially when we have these polls showing that 80% of Australians think religious schools shouldn't be allowed to sack or expel people simply because of who they are. And that includes a lot of religious Australians. In Australia, the primary culprits are the government and the bigots, religious or not. The people who are really in need of religious freedoms are, for example, Muslims, who the right frequently target. There's no evidence to show that there's a lack of religious freedom for Christians in this country. What they're really upset about is the fact that bigots like Israel Folau have a clause in their contracts requiring them to be inclusive, since he represents a major sport.
Then he'll be free to play rugby and also to say nasty things on Facebook.
Yes, that's one of the effects the bill will have.
Thank you so much, Ken, for all you're doing. You're super fierce, and I'm sure you've got a bunch of friends you're doing it with. And all over the country, all the fierce people working on this discrimination religious bill, thank you. Imagine now for a moment that we have a win and we are in the streets after this fight with our rights intact to not be vilified or refused healthcare. What song would you be dancing to, Ken?
That's a good question.
What song do you want to dance to in that moment?
The first thing that came to mind was YMCA. It's a classic.
Oh, beautiful. Well, thank you so much, Ken. So listeners, if you want to catch up with Ken and the team, you can go to their Facebook page, which is...
Community Action for Rainbow Rights.
Yay!
Everything for your mental joy. You can hang out with all the boys. It's fun to stay in the wild.
Thank you for listening to Fierce. This program celebrates the diversity of LGBTIQ identities and perspectives. Fierce is produced in Bundjalung country at 2NCR Lismore and can also be heard on podcast at fiercefm.podbean.com and in New Zealand on Fresh FM, as well as all over Australia through the Community Radio Network.